With a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again to a family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
sing, cause you pick me up. Sing, cause you're there. I can sing, cause you hear me, look, when I call to you in prayer. I can sing with my last breath. Sing, for I know that I'll sing with the angels.
Singing your
sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah, the Lamb is gone.
No matter what's happening in our lives and going on, Lord, we always stand at a fork in the road. We stand where we make a choice. We make a choice to say you're good in all things. No matter if things are going right or things are going wrong, we always have a choice. Lord, we declare this morning that you're a good, good Father. No matter where you're standing at in life right now, I challenge you. Because it's there. He always is a good Father. Sometimes we're waiting on an answer from him. Sometimes what is before us is not what we thought should be there. Sometimes we're facing difficult decisions, feelings of uncertainty and anger, but it doesn't matter. Declare him a good, good Father. Know that he is perfect in all of his ways. And remember that you are loved. We stand with that choice about ourselves. When we do things that we shouldn't have done, when we make choices that we wish we could take back, we are still loved by him. That's who we are. He stands before us in our worship. Church, your heart should be in a place of worship this morning. He dwells in the midst of that. He reads your heart, and he waits. Declare him a good, good Father that is perfect in all of his ways. And some of you may say that so easily and with so much thanks in your heart because you know how good he is and where he's brought you from and what he's done for you. That it's easy to say, oh, Lord, you're so good. You can cry out to him and say, God, you're so good in my life. And for others, it's tough. It's tough because of a situation you're in that you're not really happy about. It's tough because there's something in front of you that you haven't seen move. It's tough because you don't feel his love. It's tough because you don't forgive yourself. It's tough because the enemy keeps coming at you again and again and again. But you're loved. It's who we are. That song, those words, let them resonate in your heart this morning. Lord, we love you. We're so thankful to gather together to bring praise to your name. Thank you for being a good, good Father. In all of your ways, Lord, you are good. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you. During this next song, take that time to declare that in your heart today, to bring before him the things that you need help with. You need washed away, or you need to leave at the cross. Every day is a new day. Every day is a chance to grow closer. Every day is a choice, and he's there beside you, helping you to make that right choice. we thank you for your love and forgiveness, mercy in our lives. Thank you for being such a good Father. We praise you this morning and thank you for that. In Jesus' name. Lord, we give you praise this morning, and we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for being victorious in our lives. We give you praise this morning, Lord, for what you've done, for what you will do, and who you are, Lord. We praise you. Praise you, Jesus. You are worthy of our praises, Lord. You are worthy. You are worthy, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Give you honor and glory this morning, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day, for this moment, for this church, for these four walls, Lord God, where we can gather together and bring praise to your name. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you that your Holy Spirit moves and dwells right now in this place today. Lord, that you open our minds and our hearts to the word and to the message our pastor will bring, Lord. I thank you for each and every person that's in this place today, Lord, that's here for a reason and a purpose. You didn't get here by mistake. You're here for a reason. God, I thank you that you would open our minds to see that today, to receive what you have for us today, for a revealed understanding of who you are. Thank you, Jesus. We can see ourselves and what we need to clean out and get rid of and do better in to give you more room, Lord God. Have your way. Have your way in this place. Have your way in our hearts and our minds. Have your way. Lord God, we move aside. We give you room because we want you to be glorified. We want you to be lifted high. It's all about you, Lord. We move aside. Thank you, Jesus. I pray that you find room in our hearts right now. I pray that you find room in this place to move and to do what you want to do. That you find your people ready to receive right now. The people that have filled this place today are ready, are hungry, are fighting for you, are fighting for a new revelation. They're fighting for a new understanding. They're fighting for more of you. They're fighting to show you more love. They're fighting to get you in the number one place today. Lord God, you deserve that right now. You deserve that. And Lord God, I pray you find your people ready right now. Don't deny the gentle whisper. Don't deny what he's trying to do in you, the transformation that's trying to be in place. He will change you. Give him a second. Give him some time right now in your hearts to let him move. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we glorify you. We praise you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. You are worthy to be praised, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. You are worthy, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Give him time. It's uncomfortable sometimes. Give him room to speak. Quiet your heart and your mind to hear him. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. and goal in our lives, Lord, is laid at your feet. You are first. It is your will, Lord. And we put in our lives as number one. We submit to you, Lord God, and what you want to do, where you want to go, who you are. As tithes and offerings are gathered this morning, Lord, we give you praise. Cheerful hearts, Lord God, we give to you. We thank you for who you are. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. Jesus.
Praise God. Man, we're blessed, aren't we? Tell you what, the last 2 weeks, we haven't really had a chance to miss our worship leaders yet, right? They've done a really good job, haven't they? Yeah. Amen. 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 It's good. How many are thankful for the Holy Spirit? Anybody that's ever had to lead is thankful for the Holy Spirit. Amen. Because I've tried it without him, and don't want to go there again. That wasn't pretty. I want to share with you, just to get a little bit more laughter out of you this morning, share with you a couple of more jokes as I get started. Nothing rhymes with orange. No, it doesn't. Okay. What's red and smells like white paint? Red paint. What happens when a lumberjack doesn't know what tree to cut down next? He gets stumped. What did the fisherman say to the card magician? Pick a cod, any cod. That was good. Come on. I had a dream I was a muffler. I woke up exhausted. All right. I promise no more torture this morning. All right. No, those are fun. And when I said that that's what I grew up with, I wouldn't change it for anything. I'm really glad that my dad was the corny dad that told corny jokes. I really am. It was he kept us laughing, and it was great. So, I've shared with you all before about the blessing it is that God allows me to have 4 little disciples in my house, right? And the amazing privilege it is to pour into them every day. And I think about that all the time, and it's just like, man, it's just like I got 4 built-in disciples. I didn't even have to go find them, you know. God just sent them to me, and it was amazing. And so I get to give them Jesus. And I think about this more and more, and as I was opening up, my family gave me a gift this morning with some cards. The gift was really awesome, I have to tell you. It's a black tank top, and it says "Best Dad Ever," but the A is a Raider shield. Is that not awesome? I mean, seriously, come on. So anyway, I opened up the card, and I started reading the card, and I mean, it was a really nice card, but then as I began to read what my kids wrote in it, every single one of them had pretty much the same thing, and it said, "Daddy, thank you for being a great dad and a great example and for teaching us about Jesus." And I don't know who signed it first. Maybe one signed it and the other one saw it and was like, "Oh, yeah, that sounds good. I'll write that too." They agreed not to read what other. Okay, my wife confirms that they didn't read. But I was kind of looking at it, and for a small moment, I just thought to myself, man, do I talk about Jesus that much? And then I thought, man, I hope I do. I hope I do. I'm glad that that's the testimony. That's the legacy. That's what they see in their daddy. There's nothing more that I can give my children. That's the best thing that I could ever give them is Jesus. And so when I read that, it does something inside of me. But man, I've got 18 short years. I've got 18 short years. You that already have your kids that have raised and moved out, those years go by quick, don't they? I mean, they're here and gone. And it's like, man, I got 18 short years to invest in them, to show them Jesus, not just in what I'm saying, but what I'm doing. Every day I get to do that. What a blessing. What a privilege. Church, I just want us, this message isn't just about dads. This is about moms. This is about men. This is about women. This is about boys. This is about girls. And you know what? God is calling us to lead with a purpose. How many have ever tried to lead and not had a goal in mind? Okay, it just doesn't work, right? You know, as you can see the picture here, you know, you got to have a target goal if you're going to lead with purpose. Okay, even if it's, I want to be motivated by Jesus. Okay, because there's times where we do things, we're not motivated by Jesus. And we're not leading with the purpose that God has put inside of us. And so, I want to talk to you this morning about being a spiritual leader, a spiritual father, a spiritual mother. Because, you know, there's all of us can say, well, we have parents, okay? Obviously, we all have to have parents, or we wouldn't be here, okay? Whether or not they're present in your life or they're absent in your life, they're still parents, right? But not every one of them is a spiritual father and mother. And I thank God today that I don't just have four disciples, but I have had the opportunity to lead people to Jesus to where they made him the Lord and Savior of their lives, and I became a spiritual father to them as well. And now I get to lead everywhere I go, and everywhere I go, I get to be a spiritual father if I choose to be. Isn't that awesome? And you get to be a spiritual mother. You get to be a spiritual father. But I do want to share a quick story with you from my own life. Does anyone like to mess with their kids? Yeah, me too. Anybody like to give them a hard time? Yeah. One thing through the years with my boys is I tell them different things about being a man, right? I've said things like, well, if you want to be a man, you're going to have to eat this stuff, right? If you want to be a man, you're going to have to eat this hot sauce. Or if you want to be a man, you got to dig this hole, right? If you want steak, you have to be a man to eat steak, right? You eat this, then you'll be a man. God, it's a lot about eating, isn't it? Yeah. You make this shot, then maybe you can be a man, right? You know, it's all fun, and I like to just give them a hard time, and of course they'll look back at me like, Daddy. It's like, okay, you know, that doesn't really make you a man. I get it. But you know, sometimes I give them that hard time, but I always go full circle with them. Okay, because I don't ever want them to think that those are the things in their lives that are making them a man. Okay, eating steak doesn't make you a man. Turning 21 doesn't even make you a man. Turning 18 doesn't make you a man. Going into the military doesn't make you a man. They're going to try to make you a man, though, when you get there. All of these things don't make you a man. A man is a man when they have the man in their lives, right? Okay, and when I say the man, I mean Jesus Christ. Okay, without the man Jesus Christ, I'm not really the man that I need to be. And I always come back full circle and I say, you know what, guys, I know I give you a hard time. I know I tell you that, you know, be a man, you got to do this, you got to do that. I said, but really, serving Jesus, that's what's going to make you a man, right? Recently, the girls had gone on a camp out. And so I decided, you know what, the girls are going to be gone. It's time for a man night, right? Okay, we're going to have a man night. And you ladies, you don't even have a clue what that looks like. I know you don't. But you don't want to know, probably, right? You're perfectly content with not knowing, I'm sure. So I decided, because Crystal, you know, when she leaves, she always tries to make it easy on me. Maybe some chili dogs or some hot dogs or something, you know. And man, I texted her and I said, no, we aren't having any of that. I said, pull a couple of steaks out of the freezer. I said, do we have some potatoes? Because I'm going to fry up some potatoes tonight. I said, we're going to have us some man food, right? Okay, steak and potatoes. That says man right there. Okay, we're just getting started. So I got the steak out. I grilled them up. Man, some of the best steak I ever grilled in my life. Okay? I mean, I'll tell you, I'm good at grilling chicken. I'm not always that good at grilling steak. Okay? But this steak was really good, right? The boys were just like, oh, Daddy, it's so good, it's so good. And so we ate up on the steak. We ate the fried potatoes. The potatoes turned out excellent. So we're getting started on our man night. But then as we got done eating, we cleaned up. Yeah, the men cleaned up. You better believe it. That's right. But then we sat down to really get into our man night. And we opened up this book. And I sat there and I began to talk to my boys about really what it means to be a man. Because, you know, I put this mantle on my children, their leaders. I put that on them because I believe it. I'm calling out of them what's in there because I know there's something in there that's great. Right? And so I expect my boys to lead. Even in my house. Even with their mom. I want them to lead by example. With their sisters. I want them to lead. And so we sat down and I opened up to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. If you have your Bibles, you're welcome to turn there this morning. But I just want to share with you a little bit about what it means to be a spiritual leader. Because that's really what I was telling them that night. They just didn't know it. But I was telling them that, hey, guys, you really want to be what God wants you to be. I said, here's some great instruction from His Word. I opened up to 1 Corinthians chapter 16, and I read verse 13 and 14. Paul tells the Corinthian church this: be on guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. And do everything with love. Now, I like how the NIV, that's why I put it up there, I like how it reads as well. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be men of courage. And be strong. Do everything in love. Now, as we look at this morning, this is really, really good, especially with what we've been talking about our souls. Okay? First of all, be on guard. Right? Can I just tell you this? We have an enemy in our lives. Okay? And it's not your neighbor. It's not your family member. It's not your ex-best friend. It's not somebody that's done you wrong. That's not the enemy that we're fighting. Okay, we have an enemy in our lives, and his name is Satan. And he is only one person, but he has many imps and demons that go about and try to disrupt and destroy and do destructive things in our lives. So there is someone that we have to be on guard against, right? But here's the deal. We are victorious. Okay, I'm already victorious. No matter what he tries to do to me, I have already established victory through Jesus Christ. Amen? And so, as we open this, and I open this up, and I said, now, sons, let me explain to you what it means to be a man. And we just begin to start. And I said, first, be on guard. Just like I said, we have an enemy that wants to trip us up, that wants to see us fail, that wants to see us fall. But our responsibility is to guard our hearts and our minds. Okay? I'm the gatekeeper. I'm the guard. I stand at the gate and I say, nope, you can't come in here. Right? I'm not going to allow this thought. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, it says, bring every thought captive. Right? Okay? Is that thought, okay, I'm going to bring it captive. Is that thought good enough to go in here, or do I need to rebuke it and reject it and not allow it into my life? You've probably seen the picture before of the birds flying around somebody's head, and then you probably saw where they started making a nest, right? It's not, the problem isn't the birds flying around the head, it's when they start making a nest in your hair, okay? The thoughts aren't bad, is when the thoughts come, they're flying around, it's when we allow them to come in and we ponder on them, we think upon them, and they're destroying us, and they're leading us astray. But we talked for several weeks about the value of our souls, and this goes right along with this. Because as spiritual leaders, guess what we're doing? We're leading people to protect their souls. We're leading people to protect their souls. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 through 17, I'm thankful that God doesn't just say do something and doesn't give us wisdom to carry it out. But he says in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 13, therefore, okay, if you're going to be on guard, you got to have something, right? You got to have something to protect yourself with. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor. So you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. God has given us everything now that we need to be on guard, has he not? Okay, he said, be on guard, and then he said, here are the tools that you need to be on guard. Okay, I'm not just putting you out there helpless and hopeless. I'm giving you everything you need. I'm telling you to clothe yourself with Jesus and be on guard. And that's all you need. You can stand firm. You can stand your ground because you have Jesus Christ on your life. We have the artillery to overcome, to stand against the enemy. Can I just tell you this? John chapter 10, verse 10 says that Satan comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. And he's still doing it. He's still doing it. He's taking families and he is tearing them apart. He's taking friendships and tearing them apart. He's taking people and tearing them down. He's pointing them in the way of addiction. He's pointing them in the way of destructive lifestyles. But he's the enemy. He's the enemy. right? But here is the good news. Jesus then said, but I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. You see, the other good news is we have the power to overcome him. Okay? We're not fighting for victory today. We're fighting from victory today. Right? Okay, we're not fighting in a place where we're defeated and we're cowering down like, oh, don't destroy me. It's like, you can't destroy me. You can't destroy me. No, Jesus already beat you. He already defeated you when he hung on that cross. I am greater than you because of the blood of Jesus Christ on my life. See, we have a sword to use to destroy his lies and his attacks. This is your sword. Right? Okay? It is sharp. It is double-edged. Right? Man, I'm telling you, this will cut severely. So don't underestimate it. This is how we guard, church. We have a shield of faith. You see, here's the one thing about being a spiritual leader. In most cases, I won't just be guarding me, but I'll be guarding others as well. Until they are able to guard themselves. Okay, that's my responsibility. Until people are able to guard themselves, I have to step in and say, nope, I'm going to protect you, right? Sometimes I got to step in front of people and be like, nope, I'll quench those fiery darts for you until you get your own shield of faith. Amen? And that's what we have to do. And that's okay. Then he says, secondly, in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 13, stand firm in the faith. What great advice, right? Anybody ever been swayed to leave your faith? Everybody ever had that thought come in your mind? It'd be easier if you weren't doing this. Come on, you can be honest. I have. The enemy. Here's what the enemy tries to do to me, and he's really dumb. I mean, really. I don't know why he tries to do this to me, because it really doesn't work. Because I've told you all time and time again that I've lived both lives. If that one was so good, why don't I run back to it? Okay, this is the life worth living, right? But what he'll do is he'll come and he'll be like, man, John, don't you remember the friends you had, the good time that you had? And I'm just like, no, I don't. You know, I mean, really, you'd think he'd have better tactics. You'd think he'd have better things to come at me with, but He uses the same old junk and we still fall for it, doesn't he? So he says, stand firm in the faith. In Ephesians chapter 6, if we look back a few verses from what we just read, it says a final word. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you'll be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies. Did you hear that? We are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. That's what we're fighting against, church. I know sometimes we can look at the flesh and blood, and man, we can pinpoint them. We can say, you're the evil one. But they're not. It's what's inside of them, right? The enemy will come at you. He will try to attack you from all sides, but it's the enemy that we're fighting against. Come against him. I can tell you many times where, man, I was distraught, I was discouraged, and I got in my prayer closet, and I began to fight the enemy on my knees, and I began to come at him in the name of Jesus Christ. And man, I tell you, when I got up from there, I was no longer burdened down by what a person did to me, but I was free because I overcame the real enemy. Amen. But you see, standing firm in our faith is not something we can accomplish on our own in our own strength. We have to be connected to Christ. We have to have the right weapons and the right and fight the right battles. And in order to win, how many of you know, in order to win, you have to know who your enemy is? Okay, because if you're fighting the wrong enemy, you're never going to win. How many has ever fought the wrong enemy? Okay, he just said that our enemy is not flesh and blood. I know I fought the wrong enemy before. And man, I'm telling you, if you'll go in your prayer closet and you'll fight the real enemy, he can fix relationships way better than you can, way better than I can, right? God can do it. God can do it. The third thing that he said in verse 13 was be courageous. This word courageous means to have integrity, okay? To live a life of integrity. To be strong, to be bold. All of these things. Do you know what integrity means? Integrity is doing the right thing even when no one is watching. To be honorable, to treat others well, to lead in your home, around your friends, and in your church. Does anybody ever get tired of leading? Yeah, I do. Thanks for asking. I do. I do get tired of leading sometimes. I express to the people in Bible study on Wednesday night, sometimes I just want to lay there. Right? But John, you got to lead today. I don't want to. Right? And so I get up. I get dressed. And I go and I lead. Not because it's what I want to do. It's because of what he wants me to do. And I want to choose him every time. Philippians 1 and verse 27 says this. Above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Christ. Then whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I will know that you are standing together with one spirit and one purpose, fighting together for the faith, which is the good news. Church, if we want to be as spiritual leaders in our community, in our families, and around our friends, at our workplaces, then we have to be willing to come together in one spirit and one purpose. Because if they constantly see us fighting all the time, then why do they want what we have? If we're going to fight, let's fight together for the faith. Amen? If we're going to fight, let's fight for the lost souls that are all around us. Be the example. Let our lives reflect Christ. I have to tell you, it's an amazing privilege to represent Christ every day. God picked each one of us to be his representatives. Do you take that as a privilege, as an honor? Because really, there's no position you're going to get in life that's going to be better than that one. Can I just tell you that? You represent him. That's the greatest privilege. The last thing that he said in verse 13 was be strong. Now, this isn't talking about being a muscle man and having a great-looking physique. It's not talking about having big arms and big pecs or big thighs, muscular thighs. It's about being strong in a relationship with Christ so that his strength can shine through our weakness. Because we all have weaknesses, right? One of the story that sticks out to me when I think about this is the story, because sometimes we can look at people and be like, wow, they look so strong, man. They just look so strong. How do you know you can look strong out here and you're weak on the inside? You don't have anything going on in there. And when I think about this, I think about when Samuel went to Jesse's house for the first time to anoint David, right? He sees his older brother. He's like, oh, man, look how big he is. Look at his stature. Man, this dude right here, this is the next king. I can tell. He's like, nope. God's like, no, that's not the one. And then the next one comes in. Of course, he's big. And then he goes through all the sons. And he's like, nope, none of those are the ones. I'm like, man, God, but man, look at them. They're buff guys. Those are big dudes. He's like, yeah, we went that way before. You know, Saul was head and shoulders above them all. Yeah, that didn't really work out for us, did it? And so then he said, do you have any more sons? He said, yeah, I got one more. He's out tending the sheep, though. He's just a little fella. Well, we're telling him, bring him in. And as soon as Samuel saw him, God said, he's the one, anoint him. And we know throughout David's life and the things that he did. And when he stood, see, matter of fact, Goliath looked at him and said, am I a dog that you would bring this, it's like little twerp before me, right? Am I a dog you'd bring this little thing before? And he says, hey, buddy, okay, you're right. You know what? I may not look physically strong, but I'm going to tell you something. The one that's in me is going to defeat you, right? Amen. See, that's what it means to be strong, church. That's what it means to be strong. It's not about being strong. It's about relying on God and knowing who you are in Christ and knowing whose you are in God, right? Lastly, in verse 14, it says, do everything in love. Do everything in love. Sadly, we live in a society where love is looked at as a girly thing, right? Love is not a girly thing. Love is a very manly thing. God's the one who created it, right? But here in our country, it's romanticized, it's mushy. It's mostly physical, right? And can I tell you that love is not always just it's not physical. I mean, it can be in marriage, okay? But outside of marriage, if it's physical, that's not love. If somebody loves you, they'll wait for you. If somebody loves you, they will wait for you. But every action we have in our lives need to be motivated by a heart of love for God and a heart of love for others. If we have goals, if you have a goal today, let your main goal be to love people and love God. Let that be your goal. Without Christ, we really don't have the ability to love. Right? I want to tell you something very real and very personal. When I was 22 years old, I didn't know Jesus. But at 22 years old, God came into my sister's living room and just completely transformed my life. And when he did, he handed me this book. I didn't know how to be a dad. I didn't know how to be a husband. I didn't know how to be a Christian. I didn't know how to do anything. But then he handed me this book and he said, here you go. Read it. And as I've read it, he's given me the tools to be the man of God, the husband of God, the daddy of God. All of these things to be the spiritual father to others, all because of what he taught me by reading this book. But before I met him, I didn't know any of it. See, this book is full of wisdom. This book is full of wisdom. And it has nuggets of gold, it has diamonds that just, man, it just pours into your spirit. And when there's been times in my life where I'm like, God, I don't know what to do. And he opens up the scriptures to me and he says, here's some wisdom for you. Can I just tell you this? As I was preparing, you know, sometimes when you're preparing a message, you're like, man, God, is this from you or am I just, you know, it's Father's Day. Both scriptures that I read this morning were in my own personal devotion time, and I didn't know they were going to be there. After I already prepared the message, right? And I was like, wow, confirmation, confirmation, confirmation. Guys, God is calling us to rise up and be spiritual leaders everywhere we are. Okay, if that means being a coach, don't just be a coach. Coaches are dime a dozen. Be a spiritual leader as a coach, right? If that means you're a boss, okay, a boss, bosses, you know what? Bosses can be bossy, but don't be a bossy boss. Be a spiritual leader. Amen? Okay, if that means that you're a parent, okay, that's great, okay, don't just do this and do that. Don't be a dictator in your own home, but be a spiritual leader. Lead people to Jesus. Stand with me this morning. morning I want to end service in a little bit different way. We have men all around the sanctuary. We have spiritual leaders all around the sanctuary. I want us to encourage each other a little bit today. I want you to find about five people to get in a circle with. Five or six people. Find about five or six people to get in a circle with. Go ahead. You can go right now. I'll give you further instruction when you get there. Five or six people. I will in just a minute. All right. Has everybody got their five or six or eight or ten or whatever? All right. Church, here's what I want you to do. As spiritual leaders, I want you to speak life. I want you to speak life right now into each person around that circle. Okay, the person you get to speak life to is the one to your left. Okay, that's the person you get to speak life into. Okay, whether it's maybe it's a word from the Lord, maybe it's a prayer, whatever it is. But you have the opportunity right now to speak life into that person. And don't skip. Okay, if you're a spiritual leader, okay, don't say, I can't do this. Can't, never, could do anything. That's what I tell my kids all the time. Can't, never, could do anything. So don't skip. If you're a spiritual leader, then be a spiritual leader. And take the time to speak life into somebody today. Okay, if you're not, I understand that. But if you are, take the time to speak right now. So go ahead and start. The person to your left is who you're speaking life into. you're still praying, go ahead and keep praying, but I do want to pray a prayer over you, speak life over you today. I just want to tell you all that you are children of God, that you've been called by God, that God values you, that he thinks that you're awesome. He looks at you and he dances when he sees you. He dances over your life. He has joy in his heart because of you. And he loves you with an unconditional love. You can't stop it. Thank you for being who you are. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you, God. Because of you, Lord. Because of your potter's hands. God, you can take this clay that we call our lives. And God, you can shape it. You can mold it. God, you can make it what you desire it to be. And Lord, it's only then, Lord God, when we allow you to shape us, that we become what we need to be. And so, Father, I just pray right now, every single one of us, Lord, would be moldable clay in the Father's hands. And God, that you would, Lord, help us to keep our eyes on you always. Bless every single one of these here. Bless them and keep them. Make your face to shine upon them and give them peace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless y'all. I love you. Have a great Father's Day.